natural selection is the only theory that's ever been proposed, and I think that ever will be proposed, that's capable of accounting for the illusion of design which we see around us. So I'm not quite sure whether... I mean, Darwin thought that both natural selection and evolution itself were theories in the tentative, hypothetical sense, and he spent most of his life gathering evidence for them. I think now we've reached the point where the fact of evolution is a fact, and nobody could seriously doubt it. There is still controversy over the theory that natural selection is the dominant driving force. I think nobody would doubt that it's the dominant driving force of adaptive evolution, but many people, including me, doubt that it's the dominant driving force of all evolution as measured at the molecular level.
Maybe we'll get to that too, because I want to ask you about real... In this country, there's this... these fake controversies that have been invented in a lot of different areas, but particularly the people at places like the Discovery Institute and elsewhere have tried to put forth... It's this beautiful... I got into probably publicly talking about this in this country when in Ohio they were about to introduce the requirement in some sense that intelligent design be taught alongside evolution. And there was a debate that the Board of Education set up down in Columbus before the public and the board, and I was asked, just because I'd written something about this in the paper, asked to be on this along with another scientist who happens to be a religious biologist, Ken Miller, and then two members of the Discovery Institute. And we all thought that, I mean, I agree with you, by the way, not only do I not like the debate format, but in science it's actually very disingenuous.
Yeah.
Because first of all, it doesn't happen that way most of the time, but secondly, it gives the impression, and I'm sure you've had this, a lot of people want to be on stage to debate me about evolution or about alien abduction or whatever it is, because if you're reasonably presentable and and your arguments are interesting, someone who's out there in the audience who doesn't necessarily know what's happening will come away from it in the end saying, well, you know, he said, she said, it, you know, it sounded reasonable on both sides. And so at that debate, I made it quite clear at the beginning that this was not representative, that if it had been representative, there would have been 10,000 scientists on one side of the table and two representatives of a wacky fringe group on the other side of the table. But it's very important. But we thought that they were going to get up and say, you know, all the reasons why intelligent design should be taught. But they're really brilliant, and they have much better marketing than scientists do, for the most part. And one of the slimiest of them, who happens to be a philosopher, got up, and a rather intelligent man, he said, you know what, we don't want to force that. We're open-minded. We don't want you to require you to teach intelligent design. We just want you to teach the controversy. Now, what a brilliant statement. That was the first time it was used in this country. And it's brilliant because, of course, it's like asking, you know, when did you stop beating your wife? I mean, you can't... The minute you say it, it presumes there's a controversy, and it's brilliant because most people in this country believe that evolution is incredibly controversial, and in fact, I don't know if you know one of these statistics that's really scary. If you ask Americans, and this was done in a poll last year, forget that most Americans don't believe in evolution, at least when asked about it. That's true. By far, the majority don't believe in it. But they were asked, if, independent of what you believe, what should be taught in schools? Okay? 12% said evolution only. 24% said creationism only. And the rest of Americans were, you know, like to be open-minded, teach everything. So it's much scarier, in fact, than you might think otherwise. Yeah.
Well, it sounds so reasonable, doesn't it? I mean, by the way, there are all sorts of creation myths that you could teach. I mean, you could have hundreds of different ones. I mean, I think maybe one way to retaliate is to say, well, let's teach the controversy about reproduction, and let's have equal time for the sex theory of reproduction and the stalk theory of...
In fact, that's perfect. And I think that's what, I mean, that's an example of what, when we talk about science education, which is what you try to do. Let's bring this to an example that people can internalize and respond to. And in fact, I use the same example. In this country, there's, you know, people, it's really resonated because people think we should be open-minded. But when I point out, well, look, in that National Science Foundation survey that I talked to you about, 50% of the American public does not know the Earth goes around the sun and takes a year to do it. So therefore, in physics class, if we're worried about being open-minded, and most half the American public doesn't believe that, in physics classes, shouldn't we spend equal amount of time on the Earth-centered cosmology?
Yeah, sure. Yes.
And when you put it that way, people realize that's clearly nonsense, and it brings home the key point, which is that the purpose of education is actually not to validate ignorance, but to overcome it.
Yeah.
And so, if we're and that's the onus on scientists. If people don't understand these things, it means we're doing a bad job, and we have to do a better job. It doesn't mean we should do a worse job. And I think all of these things do reflect the fact that we as scientists, obviously you and I spend a lot of our time in one way or another trying to counteract that, but we as scientists are not doing a good job at explaining what we're doing or why we're doing it. And so I guess let me ask you a question, because one thing, you know, when we've compared our different techniques and of trying to reach people, and you know, I've argued that I have some problems sometimes with the approach you've taken, because I think I have had some. We can talk about that, and maybe we will. But the point is that we, if we continue to alienate, as scientists seem to do with the public, then we shouldn't be surprised if they don't support science. And so the question is how to overcome that. And I wanted to ask you the following question: which is more important to you, disabusing people of false notions, or convincing them to try and learn about the real things?
I'm always getting this problem. It's
I know, and that's why I brought it up.
Yeah. It's this matter of seduction and...
Which is a word I've used with you, and I get incredible trouble because of it.
And I had a little exchange with Neil deGrasse Tyson at the Beyond Belief conference, and he took me to task in very much the same terms as you have. I suppose in the particular case of the evolution-creation controversy, where I have been accused of rocking the boat and of spoiling the case for our side in the education debate, it was put to me most starkly by Rothschild, who is the lead lawyer for our side in the Dover, Pennsylvania case. And we had lunch together, we got on very well, and we talked a lot. And then at the end he said, well, thank goodness we didn't call you as an expert witness. And he was absolutely right. I would have been a disaster as an expert witness, because the lawyer for the other side would simply have said, Mr. Dawkins, is it true that you came to your atheism through evolution? And I would have had to say yes. And then he would have simply have said, my case rests, yeah. because that's enough to damn it. So the seduction technique there would be to go out to people and say, look, I respect your religion. I think your religion's great, but your religion is perfectly compatible with evolution. And you can believe, if you like, that God set evolution going. Maybe God helps evolution over some of the difficult jumps
I don't know. There, you know. So I don't think. Obviously, I have been accused of the seduction side, and which I'm proud of. I think the point is that you have to. You don't have to go bend over backwards that much. But I think that the largest impact I've ever had is going to fundamentalist colleges and saying, just simply the simple statement that you don't have to be an atheist to believe in evolution.
Yeah.
And that. Is so. I've had kids come up to me and say, "I've never heard anyone say that." I always thought you had.
How could they possibly not have heard anyone say that? Do they ever talk to a clergyman, a bishop, an archbishop?
Well, the clergy. No, you see, this isn't the Church of England.
Okay.
No, it's true. These kids, every Sunday, from the time they're too young to think, and that's why both you and I absolutely agree that I think it's sort of child abuse to subject children to that.